With me this morning. God, we do thank you, and we lift our hands in one accord today to say, blessed be your name. Thank you, God, for a wonderful new year. Thank you for a wonderful time to be in your house. Thank you for every person that came here this morning. And for whatever reason we came, Lord, I ask that that need be met. Whatever we came seeking, I pray that we leave with it. If we didn't come seeking anything other than just to be a little bit closer to you than we were when we came in, or if just to lift our hands and our hearts and our voices in one accord in praise to you with our sisters and our brothers around us, well, then we won't leave disappointed because we're here to do exactly that. We just ask you to let your spirit continue to flow through this place and let us be receptive to hear what you have to say to us, whether song or prayer, sermon, communion, whatever way that you need to speak to us. We'll hear you, God. We'll give you praise, we'll give you honor, and we'll give you glory, for it's in your name we ask these things. Amen. 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 Before you're seated, would you turn to two or three people and say, Happy New Year, you're in the right place.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The reading today is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is this child who has been born King of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of him went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. Hear what the Spirit says today.
Now, you may have come in today and said, they still have the Christmas tree up. And they still have Mary and Joseph and the baby and all sorts of stuff. Yes, we did. On purpose. It would have already come down. Since it's after Christmas, we would have already taken it down. But since Friday was Epiphany, and I really felt led that this is what we were supposed to celebrate today, and I know a lot of other churches are celebrating Epiphany today as well, even though January 6th is Epiphany. Those of you who do not know what Epiphany is, my grandmother called it Old Christmas, January 6th. Most of us know the 12 Days of Christmas song, right? Well, the 12 Days of Christmas end with January the 6th, you know, the 25th of December is Christmas. And then we start the 12 Days of Christmas, and you may have heard something called Twelfth Night. And you may have even gone out and done something celebratory on Old Christmas. Maybe your grandmother said something about Old Christmas too. I have several younger friends that really loved celebrating Epiphany this year because they said they had celebrated, they got a little gift all 12 days of Christmas. I kind of like that. I don't mind if you celebrate that with me next year. You give me gifts all the time, so that's okay. But on that, you know, I used to teach Spanish, and in the Spanish-speaking countries and in other Latin countries, the kind of traditional story is to not really celebrate. Now, in modern times, they do celebrate on December 25th, but in the olden days, and probably more in the rural areas, they like to celebrate the old Christmas. So it wasn't so much when Santa comes on the 25th that the children got their gifts and had put out stockings to be filled up. But it was actually on the 6th of January. On the 5th, they would put out their shoes, you see, with hay in their shoes, not milk and cookies, but hay in their shoes for the camels and donkeys and horses, for the wise men who come every year and deliver the gifts to the children. I like that story. I like that tradition. So if you have some straw handy and some shoes, you don't mind putting it out on the 5th of January. There's no telling. The wise men may come through. And as Stephanie, who just had a birthday this week, might say, "Bring me some gold." She'll even take it, the perfumes that go with it. Is that right? I thought that. So we'll tell you, I like that story. Well, in today's story, we find out a little bit about these wise men. They come from far off, and they're following a star. Now, usually in our traditional nativity, we have them following off in the distance. And, of course, modern theologians tell us it was probably, they probably didn't actually get to the stable right after Jesus was born. Jesus was probably a couple of years old, or almost 2 years old, when that happened, when they finally got there. And we don't know exactly how long it took them to travel over several, maybe 100 miles, over one country to another country. And they were following this star. The star was their sign. According to the scriptures, follow this sign. Now, I don't know about you, but I'd be lost, and I don't know how in the world we live without GPS for so long. And even when they screw up, they're better off than, a lot of times, they're better off than if some of us were trying to find our way around. And I still prefer it to those old maps I used to use. And I still even prefer it to going to MapQuest or some other thing on, you know, Google Maps and trying to map it out before I leave home. And you know what I have really, what I really love, and this will probably come back up later in the sermon, but what I really love about my GPS, it has on this, and you gave me that GPS, you remember that? Thank you. I will tell you that when it says navigate to, I push that button, and usually you have to start with the city, and then the street address, and then the number, all that kind of stuff. But there's one little feature that I love, and it's my favorite feature on that GPS. There have been several times I have used it, and I have messed up where I was, or I was guessing an address, or I was in needed some part of town. But no matter where I end up, I can say navigate to, and there's one special little symbol down there that says home. No matter where I am, I can find my way back home. That's my favorite feature. I love it. Now, you know, I traveled last week, and I went to 3 different states to see family and friends, and oh my goodness, did I have such a wonderful, wonderful time. And as much as I loved all of that, my favorite moment was when I got in that truck, and I plugged that GPS in, and it said, navigate to home. Now, I don't need the navigation to home from where I was, but it does keep me company. Yes. And it tells me, it counts down those miles for me, you see. I like that feature, too. I can count down the miles. I know I'm getting closer. And even though I have my dog with me, and we may have traveled over 1,000 miles while we were away, when I turn on North Flannery Road, Maddie comes up and gets on that glass and starts scratching at the glass. Doesn't matter how many miles, how many states we've been in, and it's not because that GPS is saying you're home. She knows where home is. She's my little GPS too. It was a sign, this star. Anybody ever ask you what's your sign? It's in the stars, you know, your sign. And I don't know how much you believe in all of that. I have limited beliefs in that. I think there's some general truths about that. I know that I am a typical Piscean, and I was born under that. I know I love the water, and that's the sign of Neptune, which is, you know, the god of water. And so I get that there's some relevance to all of that. But these people were following a star for a long time because they had a promise of getting somewhere and finding the Messiah. I wonder how many of us, it took a long time and a lot of signs, a lot of directional signs, pointing us to the right place before we found the Messiah. Now, it could have been in another denomination, or it could have been after leaving another denomination and thinking we were no more worthy, or we were no more available to God. Or maybe I said that backwards. Maybe we felt that God was no more available to us. Very strange thoughts. Very strange thoughts. The Bible even says in another part that signs follow believers. Now, what I have found is maybe that's for believers who believe in signs. Or maybe it's for people who are paying attention to signs. Hello. Oh, you got real quiet. You know what? When you get that quiet, either you've drifted off or I just look out and I imagine you're all sponges, just taking it all in. God showed me that one time. It was a sign. It's okay if they get real quiet, unless you see them kind of going like this. How many of us, though, walk through life on a daily basis and see sign after sign after sign after sign and refuse to see it, refuse to pay any attention, choose to ignore choices, have a chance to change it, chances, changes. Ignore it. How many of us have been in a really rotten relationship and we saw the signs how many before we got married or holy unioned or in that private moment made that love commitment? And we had a sign, this is not going to end well. But it just feels right for the moment. Let's go. And some of us that are addicted to anything but being alone. Hello. There's some people in this church that are really smart, smart people, but they're addicted to being in anything that's not alone. I can tell you my daddy claimed it, proclaimed it, told me, and I have found it to be true that there's a lot worse things than lonely. Hello. How about you've been in a dead-end job and you saw the signs coming? You were restless. You were not happy. But you weren't ready to get out and find another one because that would require you to get up and move. Well, at least I'm familiar with the potholes here, with the pits here. Anybody ever said I'm in the pits here? Maybe, this is my favorite, maybe you see the signs of a bad attitude in yourself. And I know that some of you do because you love to share it out with all of us on Facebook. You know that's my pet peeve, my biggest pet peeve, is when you're having an emotional moment, oh, I think I'll get on Facebook and tell everybody. So all of us get to enjoy your foul mood and your foul mouth. Did you know that not all signs are bad signs? Obviously, following the star was not a bad sign. Some of us have good signs, and we fail to pay attention to them. And I must tell you, at times I'm guilty of this myself. What if you're seeing someone, and all the signs are saying, go, This is good. This person is treating you like a king or a queen, whichever you prefer. But you put up a wall, something's bound to go wrong. Something's bound to go wrong. Something's bound to go wrong. I'm bound to screw this up somehow. And you talk yourself out of all those good signs coming your way. Or you meet with a little opposition from a family member or a church or a pastor. Come on. Now I know you young folks, most of you young people have not had that happen to you, but some of us old people did. How about when we get we're just kind of bored with our job, but then we get a good evaluation from our boss. Or we get a compliment from a coworker. Or somebody walks up and says, "You know, I really enjoy working with you. I'm so glad you came to work today. I really needed to see you." And we just ignore it and say, "I'm just in a rut. I'm just in a routine. I wish I could find something different to do. I'm bored." And we miss that moment of a good sign. A sign. A sign. Some signs are directional. Point, point, point. Some are signs of support. Lift us up when we don't even realize it. Some are warning signs. Danger ahead. Well, in our story today, we find that King Herod finds out about these travelers on their way to see the Christ child. And if it's really true that Jesus was up to 2 years old when this happened, Herod had by now found out that there was somebody, and there was this talk around the kingdom of this Jesus that was born, that some people were calling the Messiah and some people were saying he's born to be king of the Jews. Wait, king? But I'm the king. Somebody else here, this young person that's going to grow up? Oh, no, 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 no. Take my authority away from me. Take my kingdom away from me. Oh, no, 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 no. So what did he do? He had every male child 2 years old and under in the whole kingdom killed. Can you imagine that? You look around at some of these little ones. Can you imagine the horror that must have been? He did not mind upsetting all of the folks in his kingdom to get what he wanted. Because he knew these people were following a sign. If it was important enough for these travelers to come across a whole nation, then he best be paying attention. Here's what I want to say about King Herod. He might have been a person of authority, but he had no authority over God. And you need to know that, because that's a sign in your life. There may be people in authority over you in a job or family or whatever, but they don't have authority over what God says to you. And they don't have authority over what God speaks to you. The enemy of our souls may try to kill that God within us. But the enemy of our souls will not be successful if we say no. Because the God in us, according to the scriptures, greater is the one that's within you than the one that's without you. Hello? I like that. The one that's within is stronger than the one that's without. You've been feeling weak lately? Depend on the strong one inside. There's a bigger authority. Herod told the wise men, "Well, you go on ahead and you find this Jesus, and when you do, come back and tell me so I can go worship him too. I can go welcome him into this world." Deceiving, lying authority. But evidently he was a pretty good actor, because the wise men were planning to do exactly that. So they left and continued on their journey. But wouldn't you know it, after they give this child, they worship, they bow, they give their gifts, and there's a whole nother sermon on that, on just our worship, on us giving our gifts back to God. That's not today's sermon. At the end of that time they had with Jesus in person, they had a dream. The night that they were, their last night there, they were getting up the next day to head back to Herod, and the next day, during that night, they had a dream that was a sign. And in the dream, they were told, "Don't you go back to Herod. He was trying to deceive you." Hit that, navigate to home. Don't go back that way. Go this way. Go a different way than you came. Anybody walking differently than you came? Anybody changed in their life? Have we had some, made some choices, taken some chances, and made the right changes in our lives? I think we have. They had to go a different way. They had to change their plans. Hello? You may have to change your plans. I've had some really good plans laid out at times. And then out of the blue, the Holy Spirit changed everything. They had to get up from their sleep. Wake up. Anybody around here sleeping? I don't mean physically, I mean spiritually. Are you sleeping? It's time to wake up. It's time to get up. They had to move in a different direction. Maybe we do too. Maybe we have to move in a different direction. We have choices, you know. We can take chances. We'll have new chances. And it'll bring changes. For this year, 2012, we have signs that are all around us. God, here's what I want you to remember. God can show up wherever, whenever, however. I know this for a fact. You do not have to be up here receiving communion for God to speak to you. You don't even have to be in church. You don't have to be having a spiritual conversation with a brother or a sister in the Lord. You don't have to wait for the season of Lent for God to speak to you. You don't have to be on your knees in prayer or listening to gospel music or even listening to a televangelist or a minister on a radio. God, in fact, a lot of times for me, God shows up somewhere where I least expect it. You ever been in a place of ill repute and God show up? Because you had your plans, but God changed them? I have. I was a little disappointed, too. Might as well be honest. I was like, "Really? Now, God? Now? Now? Could this not wait 30 minutes? I mean, something." Been in a bar and God's spoken to you? Been in a drunken, under the table place? Been on a drug trip, legal or illegal? And God showed up? Been in the midst of a family quarrel and God showed up and said, just be quiet. Just walk away. You know how to solve this? Shut up. Move. Go home a different way. It has happened to me. The Holy Spirit spoke one time and told me to hold my peace. Now back then, what I interpreted that to mean was shut my mouth. But what I realized was later, and many years later, was that I had to literally hold my peace and guard it from all of that mess that was coming towards me that was not peaceful. I just held it. I held it quietly too, believe it or not. I know it's hard for you to believe I kept my mouth shut, but I did. I felt the air come up, and I felt the word form, and I started it. And God said, hold your peace, hold your peace, hold your peace, hold your peace. And I stopped before the first word was formed and backed up. That happened to me twice with the same family member. And then it dawned on me, well, don't even let it get to this point. Why am I just letting it spiral out of control? This is just foolish on my part. I don't have to be here. I can't change the situation, but I can make myself absent from it. Hello? I can see the sign. I can choose to take a chance on a change. Do it differently. I'm going to tell you something. There are signs all around us. And this year, this is what God spoke to my heart this week. This year for 2012, we need to be more aware of signs than any other time we've ever lived. Good signs and bad signs. If it's a danger sign, pay attention. A friend of mine just got out of a 9-year relationship, and the last few years have been really, really, really bad. And he said, I've known it for a long time, but I just couldn't do anything about it. I had to stay with it. Here's what I want to tell you about stuff like that, because I don't want you to just at the first sign of a problem to jump up and run. It is good for us to struggle with the signs a little bit. Do you hear me? It's not pleasant, but it's good to struggle with those signs. Maybe I need to take a second look. Not take a second look and say, oh, this is going to turn out horribly, or this is going to be like battered women's syndrome where, well, next time it'll be okay. Because see, what we've got to do is get in the middle and say, God, I don't know what's happening here. I don't want to jump ship too fast. Now, if your life's in danger, jump ship then. But if your life's not in danger, struggle with the signs. It's not always pleasant. Like I said, there's been some signs that came my way that I struggled and struggled and struggled with. But you can get there if you will do it with God and have an open mind and an open heart, open ears and open eyes so that you can see the next sign. You know, on that GPS, I can get in there and see signs as I'm driving down the road. I can see billboards off to the side, directional signs and all that stuff. But the sign I see right here is not the same sign I see a mile down the road. I got to get there first before I see that sign. You see? It's a process. There are multiple signs on this spiritual journey that we're on. So whatever the signs are that God is showing you, pay attention. Don't panic. Pay attention, but don't panic. Don't jump quickly. Struggle with it and watch for the next sign, because God will show it to you. God will show it to you. Every day can be an epiphany. I love this. When I found this the other day to wish people a happy epiphany, I noticed, of course, you know, I was an English major and I love words. So when I saw this, I was like, oh my goodness. I was like, woo, spiritually overwhelmed when I saw that. Because it can be all of these things. Look at all of these things that epiphany can be. Discovery, signs, prophecy, miracles. I like that one. But we got to follow the signs to see the epiphanies and experience them in our lives. Would you pray with me? God, thank you for this word, for not just today, but for this year that you have given us. I pray, God, you will help each one of us every single day that we live, not to just make some resolution that we've already planned to fail, or maybe some of us that made resolutions that we already have failed out in the last week. But God, help us to realize that there are choices that we can make and chances that we can take that will bring the changes in our lives that need to happen. Lord, help us to see all of the signs, the directional signs, the good signs, the warning signs. And help us to struggle with those signs, even when it's not pleasant to struggle with them, but to be open to getting on with the process and moving a little farther on the journey and traveling just like the wise men did. And remembering to stop every now and then and offer our gifts to you and worship and honor you and know, God, that you will lead us to the next sign and help us as we follow those signs. Let every day become that epiphany that we need in our lives that changes us for the better. We ask in the name of Jesus, who was born for us and whom we worship and offer our gifts to today.
Rages, I shall not be moved. On the rock of ages, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved.
So would you pray with me? God, thank you for this time we've had together. Thank you for your word today. Thank you for the wonderful music and the variety of music we have in this place. Thank you for your gifts, your love, your signs. Thank you for the epiphany. Thank you for the wise men coming and showing us the way. Not only was the star a sign to them, but they were a sign for us. And God, we do offer our gifts to you, not today, not just today, but every day. And God, we ask that you will bless as we go in whatever direction we go to eat. Bless our food, our fun, our fellowship. Bless the food to the nourishments of our bodies and our bodies to your service and your divine will. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. Amen. Shake hands and be friendly.